Dr. Rask has had a very distinguished career, continues to have a very distinguished career as an orthopedic surgeon, and has also written a book published a few years ago, Evolution by Affirming the Consequent, basically dealing with what kinds of logical arguments may or may not be used in scientific discussions, and which ones are often used but are really used unfairly. Bernie has been involved in a number of debates on, I would say, on the atheist side of the ideas of origins. I want to say that one thing that I appreciate about Dr. Rask, if you look at his book, you'll find it's very unusual, because Dr. Rask is a man who is very collegial in discussions. The book was written, but I think he hired the master, Professor Berkeley. So he paid a reviewer, professor, two different reviewers at Berkeley, say, here are my arguments, you give your responses. And both his arguments and the responses are in the book. So you see both sides. And I think that's the way science ought to work. I'm very pleased that Dr. Rask sees that's the way science ought to work, and it does work. And so I have a CV, I printed it out, it's about five pages, and I'll mark the one. If it's not on here, I know that Bart is a senior reviewer for the American Journal of Sports Medicine, I think, which is the premier sports medicine journal in the world. And to be a senior reviewer, you don't read things casually. It has to be a part of your personal disciplines that you also read the fine print. And you also, if you see a claim of something said, if there's a reference given, a citation, you go back and look at the citation. That's what a senior reviewer has to do. And this is his professional discipline. And all of that has gone into the publication of his book that was published about 4 years ago?
2013,
only 2 years ago. So I'll mention he's with the Hillsborough Orthopedic Group, has been there since 1998. He has volunteer positions. He's a volunteer reviewer for the American Journal of Sports Medicine. He did his orthopedic surgery residency at Boston University Hospitals in 1993 to 1997. And weren't you also working with the ballet at some point?
I did work with the ballet.
Yeah. Not as dance, but for the knees, right? Yeah. And what else do we have here? Sports Medicine Fellowship in Boston, the Harvard Medical School and Children's Hospital from 1991 to 1993, an internship with Michigan State University in Kalamazoo Medical School. He's a local boy from here in Oregon Health Sciences University, and I think you escaped high school here in the Portland area, didn't you?
I went to Benson High School.
Benson High School. Yep, so he's a... We're proud to call him our own here in Portland. Those are the things that he's marked down here, but I think if you look at the book for yourself, I think you'll see something that's very measured, both sides given a fair shake, and that's the way science ought to be done. So it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Rask to you. As a part of what I've mentioned is Dr. Rask's discipline of giving both sides, also, Dr. Rask has asked Bernie Dehler and provided him in advance the material that he is going to be presenting tonight, and Bernie is going to have 10 minutes for whether it's a rebuttal or an analysis. Bernie, not a bunch of questions, because the questions for the question answer period, but you know what he's going to say, so comments of whether it's right or whether it's wrong, and explain if he's right, yes, if he's wrong, why. Or if it's a question of, is this reason correct, that's fair. But no questions, we're not counting angels on the head of a pin tonight. We're not into the theological questions, we're dealing with the science questions, and that's the arena that we have under discussion tonight. And so Dr. Rask has offered for Bernie to start basically with 10 minutes, and Bernie, that's your time, and if you want to introduce your son also, since he's here with you.
Okay.
May I just mention that we're very pleased that Bernie has passed through successfully a recent surgery. So he's walking a little bit slowly, carefully, you don't bump him, but it's I don't celebrate his viewpoint, but I celebrate that he's vertical tonight.
So can
I get a few minutes to explain my background? And
oh, you have 10 minutes, and that's the Dr. Rask.
You can do another
minute
for that.
Yeah, 1 minute for that, and then, Bernie's discussion has to be on course of the subject matter at hand, and when it comes time to question and answers, the same thing. We're not discussing the existence of angels, we're discussing the scientific arguments that are raised. Are they proper or improper? One of the things you'll find in Dr. Rask, I'm going to jump ahead a little bit more here, Bernie, so your 10 minutes hasn't started yet. I was supposed to have 5. About 30 years ago, I attended what was supposed to be a debate here at PSU between a creationist and an evolutionist, but no evolutionist on the staff rose to the occasion. But the presenter was actually not a scientist, he was a historian and a logician, dealing with the arguments of what is logic, what is not, what are the fallacies that are used not only in historical investigation but in scientific investigation. And he mentioned that in a debate that he had in Berkeley with a professor, a science professor at the University of California, Berkeley, the professor said, "Well, of course evolution is true. We're here, aren't we?" And I thank you for laughing because you realize how ridiculous that is, because it's a perfect example of affirming the consequent. But a lot of people hear that kind of argument and say, "Oh, that sounds right. Yeah, okay." So there's a lot of that in the air. There's a lot of that going around, and it's not limited to the people just wandering the streets. There's a lot of that kind of logic employed in the university community. And Dr. Rask is going to address also not only issues of biochemistry, but also issues of how arguments are made and how arguments should be made. What's fair game and what is not fair game? Okay, Bernie, go ahead.
Hey, did we hit record on the channel? Okay, thank you. Okay, so I can have at least a minute to introduce myself. Less than a month ago, I thought I was healthy, and I got diagnosed with a brain tumor. So within the last under 4 weeks, I underwent, from feeling healthy and being healthy to having a brain tumor from going to surgery. And I was just released from the rehab center on Sunday at 8 a.m. So I felt alert and good enough, and so I wanted to be here. Anyway, I just wanted to throw that out there. I look death in the eye, and as an atheist, and that's a whole different topic, and it's an interesting topic, and I wish we could discuss things like this. Vern said certain topics are off the table. As far as I'm concerned, I'd like to talk about anything.
But that's not the format tonight.
I know.
It's okay.
But I'm saying that from my attitude, I appreciate it, because I want to try to influence people for the truth, and to do that, I need to know where you're at, and to take it to the next stage. And so for me, I entertain any question. And the topic of the evolution is evolution tonight, so we're going to stay up. Okay, so my Padawan here is going to drive the screen for me. I got to think about a new word, but I don't like Padawan, but anyway, he's a mini me. And okay, and by the way, this is not equal time, and that's okay with me. I'm just happy to give an analysis. Okay, so how about we say 10 minutes starts now, okay?
Up to Dr.
Okay.
This is his time, and
okay.
Whatever he gives you is yours.
Okay, so when it comes to evolution, I want to say I want to impress upon the public about scientific thinking, because the general public is scientifically naive. And let's take a question, for example. Science is into answering questions. So let's say the question, how did humanity originate? And this is a really good discussion question for atheists and Christians, because the answer is totally different. So in scientific thinking, what you want to do is you consider all the alternative hypotheses and pick which one seems best. So to oversimplify, let's just say there's two hypotheses. And in effect, you can create probably 10 versions, like God did it, or God did part of it, or God did some of it, or whatever. But two extreme hypotheses, if you just want to oversimplify, is that nature did it through evolution. No, you know, nature has no mind. And the other side is that we'll consider that God did it by God's magic. I am of the opinion that there is no God and that nature did it. There is no supernatural magic. It's just immature, anti-intellectual thinking to believe in God's magic. Bart believes in God's magic. He thinks humans were created from scratch by God's magic. So what we have here is the extreme views. Now, I know that there could be people who, in the audience, who say, I believe in evolution and I'm a Christian. That's fine, but that's a different discussion and we can't talk about all the different views. And so I purposely am oversimplifying just to bring out some points. Did I cover all the views? Okay, so one thing when I first met Bart, we'd done numerous debates, and he's anti-evolution. And I said, what's your alternative? And he goes, he didn't have an alternative, he's just anti-evolution. And I said, that's not fair. What you should do is to say, these are all the choices, and then which one matches the data set most? You know, I could be anti-anything, but what are you for? And when you have to pick something, of all the available hypotheses, it forces you to think which one best fits the data set. And so this is where I'm trying to push Bart to be for something, and over our discussions, I've seen him move that way, and so that's progress, I think. But anyway, if you say, I'm just anti-evolution, I'm not for anything, I think that's not fair, and I think that's intellectual laziness. And it's something to be ashamed of, and not to be proud of. Bart says you can't test evolution. Well, that's not true at all. That's like saying, that's the power of deductive logic. If you, my gosh, it's only 3 minutes, 16 seconds. I can go over these slides again with more detail, I think. He says you can't test evolution. Well, that's not true. There's numerous ways to test evolution. People who understand evolution are shocked that somebody would say such a thing. This is outrageous that you can't test it. All you need is deductive logic. To say that you can't test, and why would he say that you can't test evolution? Well, he says because you can't view it. For example, humans evolved from a common ancestor with the other apes and chimps. But it happened so slowly and over a long distance of time that you can't observe it, therefore it's not science. That's what he would say. Well, that's akin to saying you can't, maybe your fingernails don't grow because you can't observe it. Nobody observes their fingernails grow. It's too slow. Well, you can say, well, you can observe it over time, over a month. Yeah, but you still don't see it grow. You deduce that it grows because 1 month it's one length and next month it's another length. You don't see it grow. You deduct it through logic. And the same thing with evolution. There is a science that is brand new since about 2000, since they learned how to decode DNA. It's called genomics. And they have studied across all the different genomes. And for example, why are the whales mammals? And why are sharks fish? How did mammals get in the ocean? Well, evolution has a story for that. They have an explanation for that. The fish became land animals, and then the land animals went back to the sea. That's why whales and dolphins are mammals. But when you have magical thinking and God created everything, it's like, well, God created some fish or some fish, fish, and then some mammals, and it doesn't make sense. I mean, why would God throw fish and mammals in the sea, especially if you believe that everything was created over 6 days, on whatever day it was, two, three, or four, why would you throw mammals and fish in the sea? But it makes perfect sense according to evolution, and it seems to align with the fossil record. So, can't test evolution, really. That's like saying, you know, you guys have probably seen like CSI TV show, Crime Scene Investigators. There was a murder happened, and you know, they pieced together what happened. We can see that somebody was killed. We can see that the victim has DNA of blood of, let's say, their boyfriend, and the boyfriend has his girlfriend, dead girlfriend's blood in his car, like the O.J. Simpson case, for example. You can deduce what happened based on the evidence. You don't have to be there. You don't have to observe it. It's deductive logic. And in fact, when you if you study logic, you will find out that roughly there's three different kinds. There's deductive logic, inductive logic, and abductive logic. And abductive logic is called inference to the best explanation. So basically, when you put together a theory or a hypothesis, that's abductive logic. So you can't test evolution. Of course not. I mean that's not true. I mean, okay, next sentence. And I think Bart is pretending to know things you don't know. For example, he'll say stats. According to, he calculated the stats and this is impossible. Well, I think he's pretending to know things he can't know. He didn't have anybody calculate his stats. I think he's got obvious errors. Next line. Fused human chromosome number 2 is just one example of evidence for evolution that is irrefutable. When I was a Christian, I preached the gospel and I opposed evolution. And when I ran across this, I had to accept evolution, but I was still a Christian. And there are plenty of Christians who know science and they accept evolution. And Ken Miller is on YouTube. He's a Catholic and he tries to educate people about this. Next. So basically in summarize, evolution is solid science. It's not just basic science, or it's not barely science, it's not pseudoscience, fake science, as Bart claims. It's solid science, and when you see the world through evolutionary eyes, you see it through reality, and when you see it through God's magic, you see it through a delusion. And so, I believe in facing reality, and I used that recently when I had to face surgery and face death. I think it went better because I faced reality. So anyway, I'll leave it there. Thank you. You can clap. You can clap now.
I think you'll find Dr. Rask's comments collegial, but he might point out fallacies that were employed even in the discussion. And so it's a great game. So, okay. And what will happen, Dr. Rask will speak for about 30 minutes, then we'll have a Q&A session, and Bernie might want to ask all the questions. We won't do it that way. The first thing we'll start with, after Dr. Rask gives his presentation, if you have something you didn't understand, I didn't understand this thing, let's ask for questions of clarification first, and if there's something you didn't understand, and then secondly, we'll go to questions of whether you have agreement or, in particular, if you have disagreement about something that was said, explain why. The question-answer period is not a time for someone to stand up and hold forth with a speech or a sermon. It's a time for pointed discussion, and that's what it's about. So, is that fair enough, Dr. Rask?
Yeah, it's fair. So, just get off on the record. So, I do believe in God. I do believe in the magic of the supernatural. The reason I don't bring it up in the debates with Bernie is because I'm not an expert in that. What I am an expert is in refuting evolution. I'm not an expert in defending Genesis. I leave that to others. There are very few people who are experts in refuting evolution, and I decided to become one of them. Bernie likes to do debates of evolution versus Christianity. I like to do debates about evolution on whether or not it's a valid science. When you ask the question of which is a better theory of the origin of life, and you say that you like evolution better, you have to ask, that begs the question, well, what makes evolution such a great theory? And that is the question that I attempted to answer. We talked about that. So in the book, I had it, I reviewed many scientific articles. I tried to find out what was the real evidence for evolution. And I couldn't come up with it. I reviewed about 300 journals and from the scientific literature. In my book, I have 400 references, all of them scientific, and I tried to find what is the real science that supports evolution, and I couldn't find it. So I submitted a manuscript to an evolutionary biologist at UCal Berkeley, another one in Oregon State, and I asked them, what am I missing? Because I can't find the evidence. And what they did is they sent me 100 other references, and I read those, and I still couldn't find it. And that's the basis for my research project. So, Jerry, in the book, Why Evolution is True, he said, how do we know the creationists are wrong when they say natural selection can make small changes, but powerless to make big ones? We know of no other natural process that can build a complex adaptation. The most commonly suggested alternative takes us in the realm of supernatural. Bernie Dehler echoes this. But again, this begs the question, how do we know natural selection or evolution is a natural process? Is evolution the equivalent of the supernatural? So my goal is to be aware of proper scientific interpretation, reveal what the scientific literature can and cannot accomplish, show why evolution is not a scientific theory and is impossible, and recognize how literature claiming evolution makes unsupported conclusions. It's often quoted that DNA similarity of unrelated humans, depending on how you measure it, is 99.9 or 99.5% similar of unrelated humans. It was claimed that man and chimp DNA is 98.76% similar. The implication is that since man and chimp are so similar in their DNA, it wouldn't take much mutation in order to evolve man and chimp from a similar common ancestor. But when you read how this paper was done, it's not true. The paper was very disingenuous. What they did, if you look in the methods section, they mechanically fragmented the DNA into 300 to 600 base pair or nucleotide fragments. And they matched up the fragments. So the organization of the DNA, not even the genes, was considered. So it's like having two books and claiming that 98% of the words or syllables are similar. Now, of course, arrangement means everything. So it was a very disingenuous study. Other papers, Journal of Nature, they found we could assign the human alleles as ancestral or derived in 80% of cases, which is much less than the 98%. Journal of Gene, this isn't Genesis, this is the Journal of Gene. Only half of 384 known chimp proteins have a human counterpart. Sounds like much less than 98%. The Y chromosome was thought to be only 1.9% difference by the fragmentation method. But in the Nature Letters, a journal called Nature Letters, when they actually did direct sequencing and took into account the order in the genes, there was over a 30% difference. Does DNA similarity indicate evolutionary relationship? DNA similarity is not a verified measure of interspecies relationship. It's only verified for intra-species relationship. An example of a DNA verification relationship tool is a variable number tandem repeats, where there's repeated segments of DNA arranged like in a barcode fashion, and the closer the pattern you have, the closer the relationship. This is used in paternity suits. This is verified by human testimony. And there's other methods that are used for determining the strain, the origin of certain strains of bacteria. Now, again, does DNA similarity indicate evolutionary relationship? The problem with evolution, quote, science, is that they use these measurement tools, but they're not validated. In conventional sciences, every tool we use is validated against some gold standard. For example, you have a you want to make a new kind of scale. You validate the accuracy of the scale by weighing it, by weighing multiple things of known mass. When MRIs first came to play in the 1980s, we have these images. We didn't know what they meant. So we put pathology, known pathology from surgery and cadaver samples into an MRI, and we saw that these images correlated with these findings from surgery or from pathology. And actually in my orthopedic journal, there was a new test that came out, a test where you can measure your blood level. Now, after knee surgery, you have knee replacement, there's frequently a lot of blood loss involved, or blood transfusions. And so we routinely collect patients' blood every day to find out what their blood count is. And then it's directly measured. Well, someone came out, they published an article in the orthopedic journal just a few months ago, where they developed this little device you can just clip on your finger, and it just sits there, and it can measure the hemoglobin level or the blood count by that way. Now, how do you know it's accurate? They know it's accurate because they compared it to the direct blood test method, the gold standard. So evolution uses these tests, but these tests aren't validated. Analogy, it's like using an ultrasound to determine the age of an adult when it's only been validated to determine the age of a fetus. You can't do it. All right, fair question. If there's no evidence for evolution, then what does the literature show? Well, it's very clear. After reading about 100 papers, I was able to classify them into two groups. One is they either just show microevolution, and these are multi-generational studies. That's where they do an experiment with living creatures, and they follow it generation after generation. The other, which is the more common, are they're simply descriptions of the biologic diversity among nature, in nature, of several species, and the evolution is simply asserted. These are single generation studies. And I'll give you examples. It was claimed that E. coli, which is a small bacterium, evolved into a new species out of the Journal of Bacteria. You read, I think this was cited in Dawkins' book, and you read the abstract of the paper, and that's what the author said. He said E. coli evolved into a new species. But when you read the fine print, all he did is it changed the E. coli from a glucose metabolizing bacterium into a citrate metabolizing. And there was only one enzyme was modified by two-point mutations. No increase in complexity. Example two, it's claimed that multicellular creatures can evolve from single-cell creatures in Journal of Nature Communications. And all they did was they showed that an algae grew a thicker cell wall, causing it to clump. There was nothing was new. It was just the same thing clumped together. Nothing different either. It was also claimed that evolution of reproductive isolation can occur in Drosophila, fruit flies. And this is a classic article that's cited all over the place. And the Dr. Dobjansky, he was able over Drosophila only, it only takes 2 weeks to multiply. He had two different strains of a single species of Drosophila, and he was able to breed them, become reproductive isolated. But then you read that the author admits it was only behavioral and not physiologic reproductive isolation. Now the second literature, type of literature, is where the author simply describes the diversity in nature and the descent with modification is merely asserted. Example one, it's claimed that the flagellum can evolve more protein parts in the journal Nature Reviews. But all they did was compare the flagellum parts and numbers and DNA sequences among various species. It was a single generation study, and they just asserted that the flagellum can evolve more parts. And all they did was compare, this animal has 50 parts, this animal has 30, therefore evolution. It was also claimed in Ken Miller's book that Bernie referenced that bacteria can evolve multi-step enzymatic pathways. In this example, there's the chemical called 2,4-dinitrile toluene, which is a man-made pollutant, Journal of Bacteriology. And all the author did was they found two different strains of bacteria, one that could degrade it and one that couldn't. But he never showed that one evolved from the other. They were both living at the same time, a single generation study that happened to have different potentials of degrading. No evolution was shown, it was only asserted. Third example. Jerry Coyne, who in his book Why Evolution is True, claimed that he could show that the eye could evolve. And all he did was describe that in flatworms, they have a light-sensitive pigment. Limpets, which is a type of sea creature, had an eye cup. Ragworms, abalones had a lens, and mammals had eye muscles. And all he did was compare the different complexities of nature and simply asserted or assumed the evolution. But evolution is descent with modification from a common ancestor. All he did is describing the diversity of nature. This is the most common fallacy in evolution literature. Bernie likes to talk about pseudogenes. They allegedly have no function. They're thought to be broken remnants of previously functioning genes from a common ancestor. There is a human pseudogene. Rats can make vitamin C because they have this enzyme called GULO, GULO. And humans have a stretch of DNA that looks similar to that enzyme that rats have, which is why humans cannot make vitamin C and why we need to ingest it. But when you read the original article out of Japan, all the author showed was that there were small differences. It was a very disingenuous study. The gene for making vitamin C has what are called 12 different exons, which are segments of it. All their humans have are 5 of those. He showed there was a lot of similarity of 5 of the 12 exons. So humans don't even have 7 parts of it. What they do in these studies, they take databases. There's people do the genetic measurements. They do the genetic, look at the DNA of different species, and they put it into a computer program. And all they do is they press some buttons and they see where the DNA is similar among various species. That's how they make the conclusion. They found that there are stretches of DNA in humans that are similar to 5/12 of the enzyme in rats that makes vitamin C. So it was disingenuous study. But not only that, it doesn't show descent. Even if it were solely identical, there is the DNA similarity, as I said before, is not a validated method for determining relationship between species, only within species. There is no gold standard to confirm that what you're showing is accurate. So, the distortions of evolution. There's tests and falsification without using descent with modification. There's inferences without examples. And there are genetic evolutionary claims based on poor methodology and lack of gold standard. And the literature shows microevolution or simply describes the diversity in nature with the macroevolution asserted. So that begs the question, what would be scientific evidence for evolution? Well, you follow descendants of a common ancestor over generations become physiologically different. That is, they grow more parts and become physiologically isolated, which is the definition of evolution. Well, the criticism I get, well, that's not fair because it would take a billion years. My counter-criticism is, therefore, it can't be tested and is not a science. Conclusion. Evolution is an intellectually dishonest theory since it's taught as a science but doesn't qualify. It is a faith-based belief. Now, Bernie, he likes to contrast Genesis with evolution, and he says he assumes that evolution is a natural process and it is scientifically backed. But when you look at it, evolution is also a faith-based process. There is no evidence for it. Everything is based on distortion, and I've showed plenty of evidence. I've looked through 400 references, consulted with 2 experienced evolutionary biologists. I don't think I'm missing anything. And it is a faith-based theory because it depends upon the unseeable, unmeasurable, untestable, unfalsifiable supernatural force of billions of years of descent with modification, and it's impossible. And that's all.
The first thing is, if there's some part of the discussion that you did not understand, first of all, I have time for a few brief clarifications, something that was not clear to you, then we'll get to questions of the substance, right or wrong, So this is it.
Okay.
And Bernie, if you have one comment.
Well, he can. He's got 2 minutes. You got a lot of. Go ahead, Bernie. Ask your questions.
You know, what I observed was Bernie cheated on his tendency to respond to your presentation, but that's okay.
I don't think I cheated. I think that was an unfair comment that he just say that.
So, yeah.
And we pretty agreed that I had 10 minutes to talk to him.
Yeah, he's got his 10 minutes. Go ahead, Bernie. I'm ready.
Okay. By the way, I'd like to say that I consider Bart a friend. He's a nice guy, and you know, we talked about medical things beforehand. And I would just like to know that I had 10 minutes and he had almost an hour or so. And that's okay with me because, you know, this is an event. I just want to plant some seeds for you to consider. Okay, I wrote down 6 things that I thought were obvious. And I wanted to confront, you know, Bart. And Bart, to his credit, is looking for critical feedback, so I appreciate that. Okay, so number one, the most important thing is the title of his book, Evolution by Affirming the Consequent. He is basically saying that evolutionary theory is a logical fallacy called affirming the consequent. Okay, so let me ask you, Bart. I mean, do we both agree that, let's say, here's a deductive form of logic. It's called modus ponens. If A, then B, the first line, A, therefore B, is that an appropriate form of logic called modus ponens?
Yes.
Okay, so I could say, then using that form, I could say, if transitional fossils exist, then evolution is true. Then my next line is, transitional fossils exist, and therefore, evolution is true. So is that correct?
No. Say your first sentence first.
If transitional forms exist, then evolution is true.
That's the problem.
What's the problem with that?
The problem is you have never established that evolution is true if transitional fossils exist. You have to show that transitional fossils was caused by descent with modification. So your premise is false.
Okay, but I'm not asking if the premise is false. I'm basically stating a premise. And then based on that premise and the next premise, I'm asking if the deductive logic is true. The premise could be false, and the argument, you know, could be false because of it.
Yeah, the way you're stating it is true, but in evolution literature, that's not what they state. Okay. Since evolution is a cause, they say if cause, then effect. If
right.
Evolution, and you have it reversed, you have the effect before the cause. But anyway, you know, what I'm describing, and you may phrase it a different way,
okay. But
the evolutionary literature phrases it the first way. They say if evolution, then fossils.
Okay.
That's what's... And my title is a reflection of the literature.
Okay, so let me clarify. We both agree that if we say, if A, then B.
Yes, yes.
Is line one.
That's true.
Then line two is A.
Mm-hmm.
And then line three is therefore B.
Yes.
That is correct logic and modus ponens, deductive logic, form of logic.
Yes, but
okay.
the premise has to be true.
Okay, so
we disagree on the premise.
Okay, but we agree that that's a valid form of logic.
That is a valid form of logic.
Okay, so
yes.
Can I step in here?
By the way, I have that. I have that on the board.
Yeah, I really need to because we have a lot of people here who have come, and this is really Bart's event, and he's been very generous to give Bernie time. Bernie has another list of his 6 questions. I think we really owe it to the people here. This advertises a time to ask Dr. Rask.
Yeah, just maybe a couple more from Bernie.
Yeah,
but I think we found out where we disagree, Bernie. We disagree on the premise of that statement.
I'm ready to move on eventually.
Yeah,
okay.
There are people here that need to leave.
Okay.
I think it's unfair to them if they have questions.
Okay, well, Bernie has some thoughtful questions. Go ahead, Bernie.
To pre-agree to a format and then not follow through, Bernie, and you know the format.
The only one I saw was the 10 minutes pre.
No, it's okay. That's fine. Go ahead, Bernie.
Okay, so the second question, it seems like you don't understand the basic definition of a common ancestor. So define common ancestor.
A common ancestor is a creature that through mating or Well, a creature through reproduction created a population, and so that population would have the original creature as its common ancestor.
Do you understand, like, Dawkins in his book, Magic of Reality? You know, Dawkins is obviously, you know, a proponent of evolution. He says that over, our 198 million grandparent was a fish.
Mm-hmm.
Do you understand that?
I understand that. I don't agree with it.
Does it make sense to you?
Because no.
It doesn't make sense to you because you have a different definition of common ancestor.
No, hold on. There's a difference. My definition is based on empirical evidence. His definition is made up. You have, evolutionists have these made up definitions that aren't based on anything. We know you and your cousin have a common ancestor by virtue of your grandparents who you know could mate. There is no evidence, no one has ever shown that in sexually reproducing creatures, that a population, that two populations that cannot mate with each other have a common ancestor. That has never been shown. The only documentation of common ancestry among creatures that sexually reproduce is of members of a population that can reproduce with each other.
Okay.
The claim that you can have fish and humans don't mate with each other. There is no evidence that things that can't mate with each other have a common ancestor. That's just declared to be true.
Okay, let me clarify. So you acknowledge that your definition of common ancestor is different than Richard Dawkins.
I realize my definition is based on empirical evidence. His is just made up.
Okay, but you acknowledge that your definition of common ancestor is different than Richard Dawkins.
I acknowledge that, yes.
Okay, that was my point. And then, the audience can decide whose definition is correct. Dawkins is a trained biologist, and you as, you don't have a PhD in biology.
Ad hominem.
It's appeal to an expert. You're not an expert. You don't have a PhD in biology.
Okay, next question.
Understands that ad hominem is an attack against the person who makes the argument rather than against the argument itself. It was a correct analysis. So
okay. Okay, one more, Bernie.
Okay,
sorry.
But that was a false appeal to authority. I mean, you are not an authority on biology.
No, but I gave my rationale, and so we'll just let it go with that.
Okay.
Hold on. You agree that evolution is purportedly a science, and science has to be based on empirical evidence.
Of course.
So, is there any empirical evidence that fish and man had a common ancestor?
Yes, and it's called.
How?
Okay. Let me say this for the camera, so you can look at this later. You can look up Dennis Denema, Dennis. Denema, he's an evangelical Christian. He goes over a tutorial for evolution, the evidence in DNA alone, and it's using genomics. And he can compare a human, chimp, rat, fish, and he just shows how the bits change.
I discussed that. Interspecies DNA comparisons have not been validated. It's just declared to be true. That's not science. There's no gold standard in which you can confirm that what you're saying is accurate. I discussed that.
Okay, and you say you have surveyed the data and you have seen no evidence of evolution from between a man and a chimp, no relationship, descendant relationship or anything.
There is no evidence of a relationship.
Okay. I just don't understand how you can understand the fused human chromosome number 2. You know, we have one set of chromosomes less than chimps, and when you look at it, you can see that our two is two joined like in chimps, and the evidence for that is vestigial central mirrors and telomeres, and I don't know how you can see this vestigial central mirrors and telomeres and say there's no evidence. I just don't get it.
I know about the purported fused chromosomes, but there's no evidence. But since man and chimp pass through different genetic lines, there's no way that they can exchange chromosomes. There's no evidence that they've made it so that could ever occur.
You have no
evidence. There's no human experience that says that is possible. No one has ever documented.
It
one creature dividing into two that have different chromosome numbers, albeit they might be similar, on a gross level, not on a microscopic level. So we're talking, remember, evolution is supposed to be a science. It's based on faith that you think that there's a relationship because there's some gross similarity under 10 power microscope of their chromosomes.
Let me just summarize and I'll be done. When you look at GH human chromosome number 2, you can see a DNA sequence. And it is obvious what a centromere looks like, the DNA code for the centromere and the telomere. And it's obvious that they're vestigial. And if why would God, if God made that from scratch like you believe, there's no reason for it. But if evolution were true and nature just squashed them together, it's perfectly explainable.
If evolution were true, but there's no documentation that evolution caused it. So what you're doing is that's the fallacy of affirming the consequent. All you're describing is the diversity in nature and assuming it was caused by evolution. All right, you had a question.
I do. So I saw your documentation, and this is your rebuttal, your attachment, okay, about not being having an advanced degree in biology. And then I listened to your rebuttal on that and your explanation of biology. So my question to you is a two-part. What's your advanced degree in biology? And then two, how do you deal with Stephen Hawking's new paper on astrophysics, which after his multiple decades of exploration of the universe, his new paperwork says that with the complexity of interaction within the solar system, it's undeniable that nothing created is accidental, that there has to be a hand in something like that.
Okay, so the first question is, what about me being a representative for evolution? I did not claim to be an expert in evolution.
No, I'm not.
I claimed that Richard Dawkins was an expert in evolution, and he claimed to have his unique calculations, and who verified his calculations? Byrne. So he and Byrne.
That wasn't my question.
Excuse me?
My question was, your question to him was that he did not have an advanced degree in biology, so how could he understand this? But your rebuttal on him was a direct.
Can I just interject? These questions of people's qualifications, I don't think find are helpful. Let's focus on the data, on the evidence. It's not helpful. My discussion was about trying to rebut the theory of evolution. So let's put all those questions aside. Yes.
And let's also have Dawkins.
It's out of
place. Okay. We're gonna. That's, I find them boring. Also. Yes, sir.
Bart, if I understand you correctly, if we did not have an intelligent observer tracking events over millions or billions of years and observing every single step in a sequence of events, that we have, that therefore we do not have explicit stepwise evidence of an evolutionary event. Is that a fair summary? Because of course we don't have essentially a complete record of every transaction.
So you're asking about what would evolution, since we didn't see it actually occur.
Essentially what I'm hearing you say is that the absence of evidence is evidence of absence. That's the story.
That is, not necessarily. Absence of evidence is not evidence of absence, but absence of evidence is evidence that it's not a science.
So in the absence of having stepwise observation of every single step in the process, you could not call it a science. Is that a fair statement?
Let me answer. Remember, evolution is descent with modification. You may not have to see, actually, yes, because you don't know if generation 3 was from generation 1 unless you saw generation number 2.
Okay.
So yes, that is what is called empirical evidence. And in fact, when they did that E. coli study that I talked about, they actually saw, went stepwise, they recultured it 20,000 times, and they saw every single step that E. coli, which once metabolized glucose, then metabolized citrate. So that is an example of following every single step. Otherwise, if you have missing steps, you don't know if there's a connection. So yes. Now again, I get this from evolutionists a lot. Absence of evidence, the fact that I claim there is no evidence for evolution does not mean it didn't occur. It means it's a faith-based theory. Yes.
So the evolution, okay. So the E. coli example you gave, simply was essentially starting with metabolizing A and later on being able to metabolize B with a sequence of events observed throughout.
Yes.
Is that an evolutionary process?
It's a microevolutionary process because there's no increased number of parts.
So, wait a minute. I'm not suggesting, therefore, that unless I have a third arm, that a third arm would mean evolution, but an absence of a third arm would not mean evolution. That's an increase in the number of parts.
No, it's not. That's an incomplete increase of number of new and different interacting parts. So another arm would be wouldn't be different.
So I would need to grow a wing.
A wing, yes. Or,
A flipper.
A flipper, yes. Mm-hmm. That would be an example. That has never been documented. The difference between microevolution and macro is very clear. Now, the other thing, I'm going to challenge my question even further. What about there's roughly 20 different clotting proteins, or even 20 different flagellum proteins? I would consider macroevolution if you could follow a culture cells to grow just one more that would adhere to the prior one and be different. That has never been shown.
There have been, and I'm now stepping beyond my expertise, I will make a large disclaimer on my level of knowledge here.
Yeah, we don't care about that. That's boring to us.
But I will, because I don't want to claim expertise that I don't have. That there have been computer simulations of evolutionary processes which allow us to observe over many thousands of generations in measurable human time that have, if nothing else, paralleled what we would call evolutionary processes in biological entities.
Yes, I know about the computer processes are by their nature flawed because they don't rely on the viability of a creature, which is what evolution relies on.
A yield based on lack of knowledge.
Computer programs don't live. Don't reproduce. Yes, yeah. That are different and new.
Are you talking about gene sequences?
No. Proteins. Protein parts that interact with prior protein, like an iris to an eye, or a 21st blood clotting program, like a 21st blood clotting protein that works with the 20th blood clotting protein. New, interacting, and functional, and as to maintain or enhance a function. I've thought about it a lot.
Okay. It just wasn't clear when you say parts.
Yeah, a part can be a protein part. Not a gene, a protein part that has a function that interacts with prior. Okay.
The next question, macro versus microevolution, and this is something that I wrestle with when you're trying to think intelligently about this question, at what point do you say macroevolution has occurred in the first place? Because it's based on here's just a definition. Macroevolution is evolution at scale of separated gene pools. Macroevolution is based on changes that occur at the level of species. In contrast with microevolution, which is smaller changes, typically changes in allele frequencies within a species or population.
Yeah, I disagree with that. My definition is different. I'm sorry. That's why I didn't go into definition of species, because there are different species that can mate. For example, lions and tigers are different species. They're in the same genus, but different species.
Right, but that's biological species theory, and that's what we normally think of. Like, when you produce viable offspring via sexual reproduction, but bacteria don't have sexual reproduction in the first place, so they have to be different.
That's why I made up my own definitions, because after reading the literature, the standard definitions were too ambiguous. I tried to make it clear.
So you have a different definition of species?
No, I have a different definition of micro versus macro. And I don't involve the word species because there is a blur. And so my I don't even go with the word species because it's often subjective. Yeah. Anybody else? Yes, sir.
Well, I'm not gonna claim to be an expert in any sense in this, but
you don't have to preface that.
Okay. Well, isn't the scientific method something that's observable, testable, and repeatable?
Bingo.
So if the origin of life, I know that's kind of a different topic. But if, like, was all the information, if evolution is true, was all the information present in that first cell that arose, and can, is there like a model that explains how a genetic mutation can add information to the genome without being detrimental to the subject at hand?
The most common theory is that genes duplicate and then the duplication mutates to become something new and different.
Is there like a current model that you could show that would show that there is a positive mutation that doesn't like kill the species, because I don't know.
There are some mutations that are positive in a certain environment, like
I can tell you one
sickle cell anemia. Yes, very good.
I could tell you a brand new.
Okay, go ahead, Bernie.
Plastics are a brand new human invention. There was no organism that could digest plastic. And recently there was discovered a organism that can digest plastic. And it happened because it rearranged its genome to do it. And so that's an example of a new function arising that was never before in the history of the world.
Yeah, I know about that, and I've accounted for that in my definition. That is from a couple point mutations in an already existing enzyme. So it's no increased number of parts. It's a modification of existing parts, microevolution.
And one more question. So there is a method that shows how information can be added from like was all the information like available in that single cell? I know I'm getting kind of like.
Well, no, they have, again, like I said, they just accumulate nucleotides.
Okay.
And they produce a protein product. And that gene duplicates, and the second model, it mutates into something else. And it's called duplication and diversion, where you duplicate existing genes and the duplicated one mutates into something else, which is functional. That's the evolutionist theory. But no one has ever shown that to occur. It's a faith-based belief. Remember, evolution is supposed to be a science. Empirical evidence, National Academy of Sciences, anything that can be observed or measured is amenable to scientific investigations. Explanations cannot be based on empirical evidence or not part of science. The definition of evolution is descent with modification. You see one thing, give birth to another thing, give birth to another thing, all of which are different. That is the definition of evolution. The key thing in evolution literature is they ignore what evolution is. They focus on the outcomes and not on the process. Evolution is not an outcome. Evolution is a process purportedly to create an outcome. And that is in the second part of the study, where it's in the diversity of nature types of studies, that is ignored. Once I've told you that, if you read any evolution literature, you'll be able to classify it like I did. This goes in the micro pile, this goes in the simply the diversity of nature pile. It's very clear what the literature can show and what it can't show.
Before we take a couple of questions. There are some here who are students or in the PSU community who have interest in follow-up events or discussions. Let me know and I can pass these out as I go down. And at the back, you'll see a banner standing up. That's a picture of what's called the Sacred Tree of Sanjingzui. Uncovered in China 30 years ago this past August. In my view, it's one of the greatest archaeological relics ever uncovered. And the Chinese government estimates it to have been cast bronze probably about 3,500 years ago. In my view, it's probably older than that and requires some metallurgical studies to find out. But I'll give a presentation on that at some point in time for those who have interest. It shows a serpent, apparently tempting, a woman's hand reaching in, fruit with leaves showing danger, a a sword threatening the one who touches the serpent. It's, if you were an artisan who craft a bronze sculpture of some kind, you could, in my view, I couldn't think of any better way to depict the temptation story of Adam and Eve in Genesis than is done in that sculpture. I'll show some of the pictures that I took in Sensing Gui about 6 months ago, plus the location where it was uncovered. So we can do that on campus, other things. I'll pass this out, and then Barbara, you can take any more questions you want to take. So, anyone want
to? What country?
China. It's in Sichuan province, about 2 hours, an hour and a half drive north from
China. Yes, sir. Yeah.
In listening to a lot of these presentations, I find that the term theory is used when really it means hypothesis if we're following the standard scientific definition. Theory is testable, falsifiable, and empirical. Hypothesis is a basic premise that you're looking to prove. Is that correct?
No. You can have different theories. You can have a historical theory, a scientific theory, a faith-based theory. Evolutionists claim to be a scientific theory. My purpose was to show that it is a faith-based theory.
I understand that, but seems like presenters use the term theory when really they're not you, maybe, but they're really in hypothesis.
Yeah, I've heard that too. They say it's just a theory, meaning it doesn't have to have real hard evidence. And yes, it is just a theory, but it is claimed to be a science. What they don't realize is there are different types of theories. They sort of conflate all the hypotheses into one generic theory.
What's the difference between hypothesis and theory?
A hypothesis is where you're looking at something specific.
Yeah.
Like you hypothesize that that the flagellum of a bacterium was able to mutate one extra protein. It's more specific. A theory is an all-encompassing thing. I guess there can be some overlap. Hypothesis is a guess, yeah. It's
lower than a theory.
I go along with that.
The difference between hypothesis and theory is that theory is based by evidence.
A scientific theory is based on evidence.
What has lots of those, like you were saying before, moving parts that are going along to it, not just one train of thought. Like if you have an experiment that you're working on, you can have a hypothesis to your experiment. The reason why sometimes they get conflated is also because you think of a hypothesis a lot of times. People are either guessing or you have some basis of reason behind it, but you may not know yet. So I think a lot of times people will also say, oh, it's just a hypothesis, to really dismiss the fact that it's actually something that has a lot of evidence behind it. Now you can talk about what evidence means in one way or another, but it still has those moving parts.
Okay. Yeah, hypothesis. So you're saying a hypothesis can have evidence behind it.
Basically what they're trying to say is there's three steps of scientific proof: model, theory, law. And a model, there are many models, evolution's a model. If it fulfills the predictions, it becomes a theory, valid theory. And then over time, if the theory remains true, it becomes a law.
That's
so basically what we're trying to say is that as a model, it has not fulfilled its predictions, therefore it's not valid theory.
That's incorrect. The theory does not become a law. Theories and laws are two different things in science.
Over time, the theory does become a law.
No.
Well, again, my thesis was not theory versus hypothesis versus law. It was whether or not it's a science. And whether it's an empirical theory or law, or hypothesis, whether it meets the test of testability, falsifiable, and empirical evidence.
Actually,
my hypothesis was whether it not is a science.
Actually, a theory is greater than a law because a theory can contain multiple laws.
Well, that's getting off base. That's getting
words
off base.
Words are important.
In science, the scientific use of theory is more important than law.
Okay.
More questions? More questions?
Yes, sir.
Could you switch back to the intervention slide, please?
I'm sorry, the what?
Intervention slide.
Oh, yes. That's my favorite slide. Intervention slide. Is that the one?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
So you said there's no intervention between ancient and primate intervention.
No intervention seen.
No intervention seen. All right. Because it's not seen, doesn't mean it's actually happening. So
That's true, but that means there's no evidence for it.
Well, we can see interventions in modern animals, and we can connect that with that. So just because we can't see it doesn't mean that it's not actually happening. So
can you give me an example? What you're talking about is inference. We know that cats can get more hair with evolution based on actual experience. We know that people have traced that happening, and so you're confusing inference, which is based on prior experience, not what you might not have seen at the time. So if you want to infer that there was a man and chimp, there had to have been direct empirical evidence of changes in several other animals. What you're talking about is you're making an inference based on prior experience. But there is no prior experience with things like this. That's my whole point. You're making an inference without experience to back it up. It's like you know the raccoon got run over by a car, even if you didn't see it, because of prior human experience. I agree, and that's based on empirical evidence, human experience. There is no human experience of the intervention. Evolution is an intervention. People focus on the prior state and the outcome. They ignore the intervention. Yes, ma'am.
Well, what about the fact that you were also talking about testability and predictability, right?
Falsifiability. I didn't say predict. Oh,
you were saying.
Okay, yeah, go ahead.
To test the Bible, you also have to have prediction.
Okay.
And so then what we would see after that prediction.
That's right.
Right?
Yes.
So that's something that you can see in, you know, what the example that he was just giving as well.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, and we also have to use this inference because what is the other alternate? If God did it, we also want, we need to use.
This isn't about God. This is about the validity of the science of it, of whether I'm challenging evolution as a science. One thing people forget is that the validity, look at the definition, the common accepted definition of science, testable, falsifiable, and empirical. It has nothing to do with the fact that you don't like another theory. Because when you say you don't like creationism, that begs the question, well, what makes evolution such a great theory? So it comes back to you. You may say that you don't like creationism because it's all supernatural magic. But how do you know evolution isn't supernatural magic? I just gave a case that there's no evidence and that it has every indication that is also supernatural magic. And what is better, your faith of it in evolution or my faith of Genesis? That's what it boils down to. I made the case that evolution is just as faith-based as Genesis. Yes, ma'am.
It is a completely different question. I actually like that you tested and you showed that there are many unanswered questions. My question to you is, how open is your mind? Could you imagine the situation that you actually see the evidence that evolution is about theory?
If I saw it, I would believe it. But I spent 3 years going through 400 journal articles against spending a lot of money on two experienced and I didn't see it.
But can you imagine the situation that somebody somewhere, or maybe even you, would find the evidence?
It's unlikely. Remember, you can infer things based on more examples.
Absolutely.
Through 400 examples and two experiences, I would have thought I would have came across it. The biologists, I asked them to send me their best evidence.
Absolutely.
And I read their best evidence.
It's a similar example to the white swans.
Exactly. You're right, I didn't read all the studies, but I think with my 400 examples, I read a good representation of what is out there.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Rask, so the feedback that you got from those biologists, were they taken and impressed by your study?
No, they all thought I was crazy. It boiled down to a he said, she said stuff. Like, for example, they would say that the fossil record and DNA shows that there's a relationship, and I said, no, it doesn't show a relationship because you don't show descent with modification. And then Matsky would say, well, you're asking for infinite detail. You don't need to show infinite detail to prove that a theory is true. And I'm saying, I'm not asking for infinite, this is what goes on. And I said, I am not asking for infinite detail, I am just asking for any evidence that it was derived by descent with modification. And that's where we left off. Yes, ma'am.
I don't know if I'm gonna ask this coherently, but I've got stuck on your cholesterol example earlier on.
Yes.
Well, thank you for going back to the slide. My area is not hard science, it's human sciences. And I know that when somebody's diagnosed with high cholesterol and they're given a statin, some people will go home and take the statin as prescribed. Other people won't. Some people will come back to their follow-up blood test fasting as prescribed. Others won't. Some people will say, oh my God, I'm at risk of having a heart attack or something, and start doing the lifestyle things that their doctor is hoping they will do, whereas others go, oh, the magic pill, pop. And you don't know with an individual case which that one is. In science, you're taking a pile of cases, you're taking epidemiological research with thousands of people and inferring that an individual in your office is going to do what the aggregate of these people have shown. So my argument is, by your definition, I'm not sure any science where there's any possibility of variation because you're not watching it in the lab 24/7 is that.
That's why there's placebos.
Yeah, but double-blind placebos.
They do them all the time, double-blind.
But are you controlling for lifestyle?
So what you're saying is there's no way to show anything.
Yeah, I'm thinking there is no way, if you have to roll out inference, there's no way to prove anything. Yeah.
Remember, inference has to be based on prior experience.
Yeah, but my prior experience is my father panicked when he had his heart attack and changed his lifestyle entirely. And
You're going off on a tangent now.
No. I your information you send to me because he won't change his lifestyle to figure out what's wrong with him mentally, so he'll change his lifestyle. But you give him a pill and assume that that's going to lower whether he ever changes his lifestyle. Well,
okay, so you're picking apart my specific example.
Taking apart your specific
So example. What if I put infection up there? What if I put flesh-eating bacteria and taking vancomycin and then had it's resolved?
And there's never been spontaneous remission. I don't think.
And then you give it placebo.
If you're referring to an individual from a group you've observed and things have happened outside your observation.
That's right. That is a flaw in all science.
That's a flaw.
But the bigger flaw.
But how is it different in evolution?
Because what you're saying is that in a population of test individuals, there may be some that took it and some that didn't, correct?
Right.
When I'm saying in evolution, there is zero that took it. That's the difference.
But you know you weren't there. Yeah.
That's what I'm saying, no one was there, so no one knows if any intervention was done.
Right.
So in evolution, there's zero evidence of any intervention. And you're just saying in the medicine, there is some evidence that there may be some people that didn't have intervention and some that did. So the difference is in zero versus some.
Or that some also change their diet and their exercise.
Well, that's true. I agree with you.
More difference than the staff.
Okay, I agree.
Well,
all right.
With that, I mean, there are ways, obviously, for us to certify medicines as safe or effective. You can do questionnaires and pre- and post-interviews with people taking it to control for that as much as possible. So,
but people self-report.
Okay, you're going off on a tangent now about you're picking apart the specific example of cholesterol and diet. And, yeah, let's go off on that subject now. I think we beat a dead horse. Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir.
It's probably not a few at the same time, but I just wanted your opinion on this. And if we compare historical research, you know, everybody's been talking about, you know, we weren't there. And compare historical research, and there's plenty of things that are claimed to be known about cultures that are now extinct, and you know how they lived their lives, what they did, and we infer that from artifacts and any surviving writings. So, what is, in your opinion, the difference between that and inferences in evolution?
Historical things are not scientific. They're based on human documentation. People write things down.
Okay.
That this artifact is associated with this particular king, pharaoh of Egypt.
Okay.
And that's based on written documentation. So that's, and human observation. But you can't do an experiment to show that this artifact was made by, you can't do an experiment to confirm it. It's all based on human documentation. Science, on the other hand, can be reproduced today or over a period of time. Bernie, actually, that leaves a good point. Bernie brought up the fact that you can see what happens in time based on science, like DNA evidence. From the O.J. Simpson murders, for example, you can collect evidence to find out what happened in the past. The difference is that DNA evidence was validated with human observation. We know, like the variable number tandem repeats, that test has been validated. We know that test that is used to validate the DNA in the O.J. Simpson case is true because it was validated against people that are alive and now and confirmed that test was them. The test of things, of using DNA to do relations in the past, has no gold standard reference. You're just measuring, looking at different stretches of DNA, and no one's ever confirmed that it represents any relationship. That's the difference of what Bernie's talking about in real science, which is confirmed with the gold standard, versus pseudoscience, where they just declare a measuring device measure something.
Can I defend myself in some?
Yes.
In a crime scene investigation, nobody observes it, and that was my main point. And we can know what then went wrong, even though nobody observed it, because of deductive logic. That was my main point.
Yes, but all that.
And you seem to say that if you weren't there to observe it, it's not real science.
No.
So I basically gave a counter example where you don't have to be there because you have deductive logic, and that's all you need.
You're forgetting something.
When you look up at the stars, you see a star that is 14 billion light years away. That means it would take 14 billion light years to get there. That star may not be there. It's time travel. And
well, there's an easy answer for that. At the crime scene, even though someone didn't see it, all the evidence is analyzed based on prior experience. You may not have seen the blood come from a human, but we know from prior experience that blood is human blood and not cat blood. Not from that experience, not from that thing, but from prior experience from other examples. So anything you can infer has to be based on prior examples that other people have seen, even though you may not have been there. There has to be some human experience that says that what you're saying is rational.
Yes.
And that's what evolution is. There's no rational human observation that allows you to say that something unseen could have occurred. If you can't do it, if no one's ever seen it to occur.
I'll follow up on that.
Oh yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
We on a follow-up to that, we see ancient writing, but we don't see them writing it. Just like how we have ancient primates evolving in the mansion, but we have evidence that it happened. You just have to connect the dots.
Well, we know that writings are only produced by humans, or if it's complex. We know from our experience. Even though we didn't see who wrote it from ancient times,
exactly.
We know by experience.
Just like how we didn't see that there was no intervention scene, we have to connect the dots.
There's no experience to back up connecting the dots. Dots can only be connected if there's prior humor experience that allows you to connect the dots.
We have an unknown, and we have to solve that unknown using evidence, such as how we see that we have evidence that dogs can grow hairs during
based on human experience.
Yes, and that can happen as well as ancient primates when we change.
There's no human experience of that.
Yeah, but just using logic, you could.
But logic has to have some human experience basis. Okay, I think I've made my point. Yes, Vern.
This is kind of more a question, if I may. I heard Dr. Rask give a presentation here a couple of years ago, and
I think it was in your talk today, but I think maybe it just went past pretty quickly. But maybe you could elaborate on the thing that really impressed me the most was when you said when you read through a biochemistry book, you see that you have these pairings of receptors and the proteins that are basically signaling that if you have mutations, they both have to match. What I just remember you saying that just page after page you have these things. Could you discuss a little more the implication of that? It was in there, but you went past it pretty quickly.
Well, yeah, since evolution claims that all these molecules were derived from nothing or simpler molecules, and we know that in life all these molecules fit each other. And these molecules are derived from a computer or genetic code, which can be hundreds of nucleotides long, which are, now there's actually about 0.1% leeway. We know that the difference among humans and genes is 0.1%, so there's a little bit of leeway that's allowed. But when you're talking about hundreds of nucleotides needing to produce a protein that matches another protein and to get them to fit, multiplied by tens of thousands and having these long strings of DNA, it just boggles the mind on the possibility of it. Let's see, that's my, yeah, this one right there. So there's a gene that's hundreds of nucleotides long, and another one that's hundreds of nucleotides long. And these have to be arranged within 0.1% precision so that these match in two different organisms. I don't believe it can happen. If you want to believe it, can, yes?
Well, I would just say that's an argument from infertility because these things evolved over multiple generations and they've evolved together. It didn't simply happen overnight. This was thousands or millions of years that caused this to evolve together. They were matching, and the rest that didn't survive. So it's quite sort of simple if you follow that logic that only the ones that you see today survive to that point that they are successful.
Mm-hmm. And it makes them stronger.
Well, it's a nice faith-based theory, but there's no empirical evidence to back it up. No one has ever shown it. I looked, believe me, I looked, and I couldn't find it.
Yeah, maybe you can do it. Maybe somebody is staging an experiment where life is being created from non-living substances. That would be a cool
thing. There are studies on trying to, about abiogenesis, life created from the inanimate. And there's no evidence that can be done.
Agreed,
by this fellow named Pross, P-R-O-S-S. Yes, sir, in the back.
This is like a very specific example, but like you see like how amazing like
yes.
The wing of a bird is, like how it's like perfectly made to fly, like the weight, the hollowness of the bones, the feathers. So, like isn't the theory like that it came from reptiles, like over a period of millions of years, it gradually they turned into birds, right? So would that have turned into a bad leg before a good wing? Like how did that happen? Like how would that have turned into a wing? Would it just have happened suddenly?
No. Well, the theory of evolution says that the bad leg would have died off, and there's mutations over thousands of creatures. The ones that had the bad mutations don't survive. The ones that have good mutations survive. That's the theory of evolution.
Does it happen suddenly?
How would you say?
You can find some podcasts on this. Basically, they have experimented with chickens, for example. Chickens that have wings that are just sprouting, they're not even used. They can use them to basically like balance and go up ramps, and there's all kinds of benefits to it. So, you know, there's a creationist saying that half a wing is worthless or half an eye is worthless, but it's not true. Half an eye is very valuable. If you can sense light, that is an extreme advantage than if you can't sense light. So there's an incredible advantages to, you know, half a wing or half an eye or any half of anything.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Excellent research and talk. Thank you, Dr. Rask, for your effort and time. My question is about the inter-species mating or reproduction. So you talk about tiger, which come from generated from lion and tiger, and mule generated from horse and donkey. Is there any this kind of inner species reproduction happen in the wild, or is always under the control of humans on the farm or in the zoo?
It does happen in the wild, yes.
So if it happens in the wild, are there any of those ligers or mule, the generation mate naturally together again to generate a population of liger or mule?
Well, I looked at the ligers are only rarely fertile. There are some rare cases of fertility, but they're rare. Mules are also rarely fertile. You read the simplistic definition is they're sterile, but there are some reports of rare fertile mules that can reproduce. Mules, I don't know if it happens in nature because I think most horses are domesticated, but ligers do happen in the wild.
So this so-called interspecies reproduction either under the direction of intellectual beings like humans, or if it happened in nature in the wild, they won't be able to generate a new population of species. Is that safe to say that?
Again, you're talking about the definition of species. I don't define species. What I defined is physiologic differences, such as increased number of parts and inability to do any reproduction at all. So I don't go into species because that muddles the water. Early in my research, I tried using that definition, it doesn't fit. And so I don't make any claims based on the taxonomic definition of the word species. My claims of micro, which is possible, versus macro, which has no evidence, is based on the number of parts, which are new and different and interact, and the complete lack of ability to mate.
Can I say something?
Thank you.
Can I say something?
Yes.
What's a really interesting factoid along these lines is human evolution. Evolutionary scientists say that humans and Denisovans and Neanderthals intermated, and they are different species. So that's an interesting thing.
What made it?
Yeah. Some of we have Neanderthal DNA in our genome and. Denisovan. Denisovan is European and, no, Denisovan is Asian and Neanderthal is European.
Are they both humans?
No, they're not human.
Yeah,
they're not homo sapiens.
What that is it's a comparison of DNA and there's similarities of DNA. And from that, it's assumed that there's a relationship based. So that falls into the category of looking at the diversity of nature and assuming that there was evolution involved, even though the descent with modification wasn't shown. That falls into that category of study.
That's not my question. My question is that those
interspecies mating
happen in the wild or not. If yes,
sometimes
they generate a new population of the similar stuff. Or if you don't have species similar
yes.
animal or organism.
Well,
they
coyotes
can.
Coyotes and dogs have had fertile offspring.
So if they're fertile, can they generate a population?
But they're statistically so rare that you really can't answer
but
the question.
But you have to have a population in order to form a real a group of so-called new species.
Yeah, that's why I don't get into species definition. It muddles the water, so we're going to stay away from that.
So my second question would be about the antibiotic
resistance
of microbes like bacteria or viruses. To my knowledge, all those changes happen in a closed system, either in an organism, in the body, human body, for example, or in a dish, in the lab. The pressure created by humans, if it happens in nature, that resistance might not happen because all the microorganisms have the ability to stay away from harm. That's naturally happening. If it's an open system, if there's natural pressure on them, they stay away. They will not, it's much easier for them to stay away. It's naturally happening than change their genes to become resistant to the environment. But those antibiotic microbes happen in a closed system. If it happens naturally in the wild organism, that organism dies or distinct because of the microbe growth. But in human, because we have this medical system, we give antibiotics. If it doesn't work, we give more, we give new, and we keep doing that to add pressure in the on those microbes in the closed system. That causes, there's no way for those microbes to go. So that causes a gene change, to my knowledge, of those microbes. Or it happens in the dish, in the lab. Is that safe to say that?
Yeah, that's an example of microevolution. There's two ways of developing antibiotic resistance. One is through horizontal gene transfer of a pre-existing gene. And in fact, the gene for penicillin resistance actually existed before the introduction of penicillin. Remember, penicillin is made by a fungus or a mold. And so the drug already existed, and therefore, and then we know there was a study by Esther Lederberg, I believe, in the 1940s. Before penicillin was widespread use, she discovered penicillinase, which is the resistant gene or the resistant enzyme to penicillin. Now, so that wasn't a direct mutation, but there are examples of antibiotic resistance that are from direct mutation, and it's usually from one or two changes of a nucleotide to modify. Usually it's these transport proteins, which are in the cell membrane that allow it to leak out or prevent it from coming in and doing destruction. So they're usually small changes, like one or two base pairs, that modify a cell membrane protein that render the antibiotic effective. Another example of microevolution. No new parts.
Thank you, I appreciate it.
I thought about this.
Would it be okay if we asked, if others have specific questions, maybe we could
put let me ask the young fellow there some question.
Just two quick questions. Would you agree with the statement that an intelligent creator would create beings that are able to adapt to their environment and survive? Number one, like just to survive, you know, like I guess microevolution, I think that an intelligent creator would create beings that are able.
Well, I believe an intelligent creator, yes.
Yeah, I do too, but I'm just asking, like, that makes sense to me.
No, like I said, there's small changes that can be made, microevolution, that is well documented. Mm-hmm. Like growing more hair, some cats and dogs have thicker furs based on random mutations that make them grow more hair. The ones that have less hair die off in the cold environment, so leaving the ones with more hair to reproduce. That's well documented, and we know that from direct human experience.
And my second question is, this is kind of like elementary, I'm sorry if you went over this, but what are your thoughts on like the fossil record? Because I just feel like it's kind of lacking, like there should be like millions more transitional fossils.
My answer is very simple. The fossil record shows that there existed creatures a long time ago that are now extinct. That's all a scientist can say.
Okay.
There's nothing in the fossil record where you can make an inference about relationship. All those relationships are contrived and arbitrary because there's no medical science to connect the dots.
And like, would you say, like, I just noticed like there's just like a lot of like artwork involved and not as much empirical evidence as I'd like for like these transitional fossils, but that's just kind of what I've come to know.
Well, again, this is an example of what I actually may put this up again because we're going over something. Remember, there's two types of studies that I discovered in the, that falls into the two types of studies. Mm-hmm. That falls in the description of the diversity of nature type of study. With the evolution simply asserted. Those are single generation studies. And then we just talked about the antibiotic resistance, which is the multi-generation study. So simply describing what's in nature, the differences, doesn't mean they're related. Unless you know from prior experience, we come back on this prior experience, nothing we know as humans, as thinking scientific beings, we can think of as real in the world of science, unless there's somebody observed it somewhere. Remember, National Academy of Sciences, anything that can be observed or measured. There's no observation or measurement of a relationship among those fossils. I am just using the evolutionists' definitions against them. It's all, like I said, it's all distortions of logic.
Thank you.
Oh, that's fine, but that's a faith-based theory.
Yeah, we're all here together.
That's right. Yes, Lee.
Doesn't evolution depend a lot on mutations? That this thing mutated and build itself up? Now, what about mutations? Are they going to build themselves up into a situation where they're stable, or are they going to be destructive?
Well, they only modify existing parts or destroy existing parts. They don't create new interacting parts. There's no evidence of the ability of random mutation and natural selection to create new interacting parts that function, that enhance or maintain a function.
And I gave an example of a new function that never existed prior in the world.
What was that?
The ability of an organism to digest plastic.
Yeah, a new function, but it's not a new part that interacts.
It's a new function that didn't exist, and it basically was two unrelated genes that came together to create a function, because there's a target rich environment, and something happened, and nature stumbled upon it, and then once there's a target rich environment, it just took hold.
No, that's either a single modification. That might be the dinitrile toluene example, where they saw two different strains of bacteria. One was metabolizing the plastic or the product thereof, and one didn't, and the author just assumed one came from the other, but he didn't show it.
Well,
so the difference is in the fine print. You have to read on how that study was done.
Yeah.
And I think it's the 2,4 dinitrile toluene study that I cited.
Okay, well, for anybody who wants to do further research, there's a Christian evangelical who believes in evolution, and he combats the ID, the intelligent design movement. His name is Densbina. He wrote for Biologos, which is a Christian group supporting evolution, because evolution is solid science. And this is one major article that they have against the Discovery Institute, intelligent design. And they say this is a major argument against intelligent design. So.
Okay, well, again, the devil's in the details about that. I think I came across that, and it just showed two species that coexisted. One was not the, but, yes, Jersey.
Thank you. So just following up on this question that evolution processes supposedly are only based on mutations. But we also talked about the gene transfer, so virus insertions and other things. So it's not purely being able to mutate existing genes, but it's also an insertion, expansion of gene structure in DNA based on some random viruses that humans or other species encounter as they go forward. Have you examined that?
Well, that's called horizontal gene transfer,
right.
Yeah. And now, but the
I just
the
wanted to
point,
explain more what it means.
Yeah, but the point is that gene is not new to the environment. It was new to the individual. And the evolution says there's new things that came up that never existed anywhere before.
No, we don't know the process, right? We don't know the process by which the organism, all of the species got this new function. It couldn't be a gene transfer or anything else.
Well, sometimes they do. They can actually see horizontal gene transfer under a microscope. Yeah.
But that could cause potentially a new function or a new part.
It transfers function. Now, you can get new functions, like I said, with the E. coli example, where you can get a new function where you metabolize glucose and then citrate. And that's an example of microevolution, because it involves, in that case, it involved just changed two nucleotides within one enzyme. So there was no new product, no new part. It was changing an existing part. It's like, I'll give you another example. In skin color, there's the melanocyte hormone. I might get it wrong. A hormone attaches to a receptor, and the color change is due to slight modifications in the receptor, and you can get different skin colors or different hues of the melanin, the pigment. So if there's no new parts in color changes, there's only a slight change of one part, the receptor, and that's what you're talking about. That's all micro. I agree, there's plenty of evidence for that.
I will follow up on the discussion that we had in the last debate. admitted at that time that those things like the evolution, the microevolution, could occur within the plant species.
Yeah, well, I don't know. See, I didn't investigate the plant species. I restricted my talk and research to bacteria and animals. Plants get a little I don't have much training in plant species. My background is in biology or zoology and microbiology. I have my bachelor's degree in microbiology and human animal physiology. I don't know much about plants, so I didn't even go there. Yes, sir.
I'd like to make a quick statement here. We don't need human experience for a lot of scientific topics.
Like, a lot of what?
We don't need a human experience. We don't need human experience because we don't use human experience to find out how the Earth was made. And if we just used human experience only to find out the unknowns, we wouldn't have gone anywhere in the scientific field at all. We would have gotten nowhere.
You have to, but it has to be, you may not have the experience, but you have to be able to do a test to obtain it.
Yeah.
So your hypothesis or theory has to be testable, and then you gain it after that. You're right, you can come up with a hypothesis which has no human experience, but then you have to test it to gain the human experience. I agree with you. That's my whole point. Since you can't test it, you can't call it a science.
So it's basically just saying that the Earth could not have been, it kind of like just contradicts like the entire way of how Earth was made because we didn't have human experience.
There's no science that tells us how the Earth was made.
Okay, so are you
sometimes things aren't.
Are you denying the number one way how the Earth was made in all schools as well as evolution?
I repeat the question, please.
Are you denying that the Earth was made from meteors smashing into each other?
Nobody knows that.
Well, it's proven. We can even test it as well, using gravity.
Oh, you might be able to test a little.
We can test it using gravitational equations.
I don't believe you. I don't think there's a connection.
Mass in space and that it can attract bigger things of mass, and it can actually attract it.
And that's why what you're claiming is not considered, I would consider a scientific hypothesis, your theory, because there's no human experience to back it up.
So you don't think that how Earth was made is a scientific
theory? No, because there's no way you can test it. There's a lot of things in science we can't answer. Many historical things we can't answer.
So you deny that how Earth was made is not a scientific
theory? Your theory is not a scientific theory, because I agree with you. It's not a scientific theory because there's no way you can test it.
It is testable through gravitational equations.
That's not showing the Earth being created.
You can use gravitational equations to find out how the Earth was made.
No one has shown the connection between the two. We'll have to leave it at that.
Yeah, I think there's a repetition. That's about the fourth time you said it.
Anything else? Jersey.
I'll jump again. So based on that idea of historical description of historical theory, would you also consider the Bible being the realm of completely unscientific, faith-based, nothing really proven, no evidence to such substantiate?
All right, we're changing the subject, but I'll go along with that since it's the end.
It was there as one of the
right, ones. Okay. Yeah, it's the Bible, I believe, is a historical truth, just like the fact that you ate a hamburger last week is a historical truth. It's hearsay, and we trust the people that wrote it down, just like we trust the people that wrote down that there was a Holocaust, like we trust the people that wrote down. Okay, I won't go there. Just like we trust the people that, that documented the, like that there was a Civil War. All the witnesses are dead of the Civil War, but we know it occurred. We know the details about it because humans there wrote it down and passed it on. We know that there was a Julius Caesar and an Alexander the Great, because people wrote down about what they did and they passed it down. Similarly, the Bible. We know that there was a God because Moses witnessed it. We know that there was a Genesis because God told Moses and he wrote it down. Some people choose to believe what was written down about human history and some choose not to. But I agree with you, there's no way to prove one way or the other. We take, based on faith, that what was written down is true. And those that believe in evolution just flatly deny the written documents. And those that believe in it, believe it. Just like we believe that the written documents about the Black Plague in Europe. Historical. Historical truths versus scientific truths. Yes.
Not as a moderator, as a member of the audience, if I could. In my understanding, yes, the Bible is a document of history, it's a document of spiritual truth. It's also, in my understanding, a document of historical truth, history, well recognized. But when it touches in many areas of science, we find things true today that weren't really understood. For example, 15 or 16 times the Bible is mentioned. 15 or 16 times the Bible mentions the stretching out of the heavens. And that wasn't really understood. You can see the famous picture of Einstein and Hubble peering through the telescope around 1929, the photos that it was at Mount Palomar. Hubble was explaining the expansion of the universe. That was less than 100 years ago, but thousands of years ago, the scripture more than 15 times mentions the stretching out of the heavens. That's true. So when it touches in areas of science, there's truth. There are many more examples, but I just want to make sure that people know that there are examples that when the scripture touches in science, we find it to be true when we look carefully enough.
Thank you. Anybody else? Did I dazzle anybody with new information? That... Yes, sir, you were quiet. Thank you. Now, one thing. Is it Chad? You need to read a book on logic and look up inference and the fact that inference needs to have examples in order to infer. And so we beat a dead horse here, but go and read about, remember I talked about how you have two swans, you can infer all that are white, 400. You can infer all that are white, but it's stronger, more strongly inferred. But if you have zero swans, you can't assume all swans are white. But anyway, that's the basis. So go ahead and read about it. We're not going to talk about it anymore. We beat a dead herd, of course. So I think most in evolution, they disregard the rules of inference. And that is all over the literature. Anything else? Right.
The more likely it is to be true.
The more likely that all of them are white.
Right. So the more things that you see, that you expect to see in a theory like evolution, the more likely it is to be true. Now, that doesn't mean that you can't have one black swan and the whole thing goes kaput.
That's right.
Because a lot of times, what people talk about with the fossil record, with also seeing, you know, if you had, like the rabbit where the ancestral rabbit should be, or ancestral animal. Therefore, that would be an example of a way which evolution didn't predict anything, and it would be falsifiable.
Well, like I showed in my example, to falsify evolution, you would have to show that the ancestral rabbit with descent with modification did not turn into the modern rabbit. And that can't be done because you can't follow it over billions of years.
I know, but that's like... That's,
I know, I'm sorry, but that's the science.
Like the world that follows a paper.
That's why it's not a science.
I really appreciate your talk, though, and you have a lot of details in there, and I appreciate
it. Okay.
That.
voice is gone. Thank you, everybody.